Spirit for this evening as well. I already welcome my friends and myself, but over the last few weeks I've had the opportunity to make very great friendships, some that I hope will endure over the next few months and certainly over the next few years. But we are here now as one family, members of the Barbados Labour Party family, and what a family it is. It is my honor and my privilege to speak on behalf of the oldest political institution in the English-speaking Caribbean, with a deep tradition of excellence. And you only heard the tip of the iceberg when Dr. Walker spoke. But I want to tell you a bit about myself and why it is that I am here, and why I would choose to speak this evening on leadership, and hopefully share with you my story and what it means to have the opportunity to be here. I grew up in the Pines. Everybody who knows me knows this. It is perhaps one of the things of which I am most proud. But in many communities in Barbados, and many persons born into those communities that are considered troubled or challenged, I have seen firsthand what it is for people to work hard day in and day out and not achieve success. And some of the brightest, most dedicated, hardest working people that I have met and known in my life came from the Pine, and communities like the Pine, but were not able to go on to make the most of the opportunities that exist in a country like Barbados. And I made it my life's mission to try to understand this. Why is it that people who I know to be tremendously bright and tremendously gifted could not elevate themselves above and beyond the circumstances of their birth, even in a country as great as Barbados is? And so I made a commitment to study social policy, to try to understand not only the people that live in these constituencies and these communities, but to try to understand the structures and the systems that serve to reinforce existing patterns of inequality and deprivation, and prevent people born to honest parents from being able to achieve the most that they can in their own time. And having studied social policy, and having had the opportunity to lead two government departments responsible for the delivery of social service, I came to the realization that there was something missing. And beyond understanding social policy, there was a need to understand one other thing. And that thing is leadership. And why is it that notwithstanding everything that was done, policies that were implemented, people were still suffering in this country? People that I know, my friends, my mother's friends, and friends of my mother. It has really captured my attention. Why is it that we can design policies to help people, but that these policies don't translate to improving lives for people? Either we design poor policies, or policies are implemented badly. Leadership, the missing ingredient for taking Barbados forward. This is a time for leadership. And I will not spend much time this evening trying to prove to you that Barbados is in crisis. You need only walk the streets to know this. I have a friend who told me recently that the only thing in her cupboard is cobweb. That would be funny if it weren't so serious. And you don't need to have an academic definition of poverty to understand what it is to be poor. When someone can honestly say to you that all they have in their cupboard is cobweb, then we know we have a fundamental challenge in Barbados and that this needs to be addressed. And so, I want to talk this evening during my very short presentation on leadership and marry it to a certain extent with events occurring in our social sector, and to try to prove to you that there has to be and there must be a better way for people, because we cannot continue to leave people in the hands of the people who are now taking control for the destiny. But I want to make a distinction between leadership and authority. I do so to give you the mental freedom to evaluate the persons who assume now some of the highest offices in our land, so that you can evaluate someone who holds an authority position and say to yourself whether this person is exercising leadership or not. A person, for example, can be a CEO, and we will call that person a leader, regardless of whether that person is leading or not. A person can be a president and can do some of the most heinous things to other people, and we will call that person a leader, whether that person is leading or not. We confuse authority with leadership. Not everyone who holds a position of authority is leading. And there are many people who do not hold a position of authority and are leading every single day. It is for this reason that I feel that we have to clarify in our minds what really is authority and what really is leadership. These are uncertain times. When times are calm, when things are good, we really don't need leadership. You need a steady hand, a manager. But when times are uncertain and things are difficult, you need leadership. Someone to take control of the ship and lead us into the direction that we know we should. So, we have to ask ourselves honestly, is what we are experiencing now leadership? I want to give you the freedom in your mind to think about it, because we can say that a CEO is not leading. We can say that a president is not leading. Then it would also be fair to say that the prime minister is not leading. Now, authority works well for technical problems. And technical problems are things for which we already have a solution. We know what to do. If I break my arm, I go to the doctor, he's going to set it. It's a technical problem. But if I continuously break my hand, and I'm engaged in behaviors that jeopardize my life, then I have an adaptive issue, behaviors that I know must change so that I would not injure myself, my family, or anyone else. Adaptive challenges are things to which we do not yet have a solution. They require working with people, and it's a lot more than using authority to resolve. But authority figures use protection, direction, and order. I want to introduce you to my friend, I call him Bob. Bob is a silverback gorilla. In the jungle, if somebody opposes the silverback gorilla or the pack, the silverback will run to the front. He will assume responsibility for protection. The silverback will direct the rest of the troops, this is where to go, this is how you do it, this is what has to be done. And when everything is said and done, the silverback will maintain the status quo. Everything must be in order. And that works well for the silverback, because he knows his enemy. A few years after the silverback established himself as the pack leader, the silverback is now introduced to man, who enters the jungle with a machine gun and tanks. But of course, he does what he knows to do. He runs to the front. He assumes his position as the protector. But in the face of a machine gun and the uncertainty, he finds himself extinct. He finds himself in trouble and leaves his entire pack down the drain, off the cliff. It is the same thing. We are living in uncertain times. And we have promoted people who have been able to exercise authority over time. But in the face of uncertainty, they are running to the front, beating their chest like a silverback, but leading Barbadians off a cliff. Much like Bob. I want you all to get familiar with Bob. No, I'm not saying that you cannot lead with authority. Because if you practice leadership, if you have authority, then it's a good thing. But authority can also be a straitjacket if you do not know how to use it. And we should not be surprised, because it is said that we share about 95% of our DNA with chimpanzees. And maybe 4 or 5% different. It's true. But that 4 or 5% should give us the capacity to be compassionate, to be curious, and to care, especially about the plight of people. It should give us the capacity that in uncertain times, it makes no sense to behave as an authority figure when you do not know the solution. It makes sense, therefore, to return to the people, because authority is power that is given for a service. And the people that gave you that power also have the power to take it back. But if you are not engaging these people, if in a time of hurt, when people are most suffering, and they come to you and they say, I am in pain, and your response is to rely on your authority, then we have a real big problem. And I want to use 2 examples this evening, perhaps not to prove my point, but more as a matter of concern that is worthy of discussion. Leadership in uncertain times requires compassion and curiosity, because people are hurting. And if people are hurting, they will turn to you and they will ask for some support, and they will expect empathy. And sometimes they get none. But here is the thing. Kliko. Let me tell you all about Kliko. People invested all they had in Kliko. And some people invested everything they could afford in Kliko. And whether or not they invested all or everything, the point is that they invested in Kliko, and it's the money, and they want it back. So in a time of hurt, and in a time of uncertainty, people turn to their authority figure, not their leader, and they say, I am hurting, where is my money? The man who we know to be benefiting most from Kliko, we want him to be called to account for this. And our authority figure responds, this man is my friend. Should I shun him? He is not a leper. Now imagine people have turned to you in a time of uncertainty and in a time of great pain, looking for compassion, which is the difference between the chimpanzee and us. That 4% is important. But we respond as if we don't have that 4% and therefore show no compassion and no care. And again, people are suffering and people are hurting in this country. And things are really bad. And we have just decided to spend $7 million or more on some 50th year celebration, a party. Now, people are not saying you cannot spend money on a party. They do not think $7 million in and of itself is a hell of a lot of money. But they are saying, I cannot afford to celebrate my own birthday. I cannot afford to celebrate the birthday of my children. And God forbid, I cannot take my wife out for her anniversary. But yet, in my time of pain, when I turn to you and I say to you, this is my current reality, your response is something to do with the value of oil in the Bible. Because when you say things from the Bible, it barricades you from any kind of criticism. Your response is to speak about the Bible and to tell people, like it or lump it, part two. Because that's basically what we got. I am holding this event regardless of what you say and what you think. So now we have reinvented Sandy. But Barbadians are a very disciplined people. And Barbadians for years, I'm not even using it for a point, which is interesting. Because Dr. Walker and I had a conversation about whether I should use it for a point or not. He didn't think I should. And he insisted. Yeah, let's look at Bob. The Barbadians have, for the longest time, borne the brunt of the struggle in this country. For the very longest time. And they do so out of a sense of respect and out of a sense of trust of their leadership. And people across the region call us a cowardly people. They even think that we are a simple people. But what they don't understand is that Barbadians are a big picture people, and that we will give ourselves to our leadership if it is that we trust our leadership. And when they ask out of genuine concern for you to look after their welfare, we have a responsibility, because they don't ask often, to take that concern very seriously. But when Barbadians feel disrespected, when Barbadians are asked to carry a cross that they should not bear, it is only a matter of time, perhaps 18 months or so, before they say to you, enough is enough. The time shall soon come. And I want you all to understand the nature of the problem that we are dealing with. We really must. And when it is that our emotions are triggered as a country, we need to pay attention and to listen to our emotions, because our emotions will tell us what it is that we value. And so if the collective emotion of a country is stirred to the extent that people are offended, it is only because some person in authority is acting in a way that is outside our value system. And we know better, and we expect better from our leaders. And I want to talk to you now briefly about the leaders of the past. And Jerome spoke very briefly about Granley Adams. And if you understand the times in which the Barbadian Party was formed in 1938, and the hardships that the country was experiencing then, both economically and socially, and the struggles that were being placed on people coming up against a planter class that cared very little for those who formerly worked on the plantations, then who in their right mind can deny Granley Adams his due? And the successes of Granley Adams are numerous. But I like most the fact, and Jerome mentioned it, but I don't think a lot of people heard it, that the Barbados Labour Party started the Barbados Workers Union to protect poor people. The union really is our legacy. And we should not surrender it to any other person. Barbadians should know that the Barbados Labour Party has always and will always care for poor people. But this is leadership that resulted in many things during that time. But I say to you, it is not the things that were done, but it is the thinking behind the things that were done. And Errol Barr, in his own way, made a significant contribution to Barbados too. We have to give Barr his due. And Barr has been able to claim free education, but we know that's a little bit doubtful. But he's been able to do things in education, he's been able to do things in school meals. But Errol Barr made a contribution to Barbados too, understanding that it took mobilizing people to be able to do very, very difficult work in and for people, through people. But Tom Adams, in his own time, was a revolutionary. And it is a pleasure to be speaking in this Tom Adams Financial Center. In his own time, a revolutionary, having done so much for people during the time that he led this country. And his achievements are numerous. The National Petroleum Corporation, the Insurance Corporation of Barbados, because they have an interest in social stuff, all the work that he did in relation to giving housing to poor people, the Tenantry Freehold Purchase Act, which allowed plantation tenants the opportunity to purchase land at 10 cents a square foot, giving poor people a chance to own a piece of the rock, the Barbados Drug Service, in his time a revolutionary. And Tom Adams deserved his due, and we should give it to Tom Adams too. But because this is a conversation on leadership, I will leave Sandy Ford out. We can have that in the question and answer session. Prime Minister Arthur. When Arthur returned hope to people in a time when people had lost hope, you hear? When Owen assumed responsibility for the country, unemployment stood at 26%. While I was still a relatively young person at the time, I understood and I remember when Prime Minister Arthur was saying job number one is job. And people said, always said we were going to take Barbados down to a point where unemployment was negligible. And statistically, he did it. We moved unemployment from 26% at one point to single digit. You imagine? That is an insane achievement. And it needs to be told. And Prime Minister Arthur has done a lot for this country. In my mind, we do not pay enough respect to the man. And we should honor these people when they're alive, even if, you know, they're behaving a little bit naughty. But I am an unrepentant and unrelenting regionalist. I believe in regionalism. I do not think Barbados can stand on its own. And I think one of Owen's greatest achievements was the effort he made in making the CSME a reality. And a few weeks ago, when I was in St. Lucia on business, the guy who picked me up at the airport, a taxi man whom I'd never met in my life, but who heard my accent and said, "Are you from Barbados?" asked me what it is that is happening in Barbados. He said to me, he remembered when Arthur was Prime Minister of Barbados, he felt as if the Caribbean had a Prime Minister. And I will always support regionalism, and to the best of my knowledge, regionalism is still part of the constitution of the Labour Party. But now, here we are, 2016. And our nation state has been built by brilliant leadership, there is no doubt. We've had lots of international acclaim. Kofi Annan, when he was General Secretary of the United Nations, remarked that Barbados is a country that punches above its weight. That's a big statement. Yeah. Barbados punches above its weight. More recently, Ralph Gonzalez, the Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, wrote a wonderful paper, short it is, you should read it, on the idea of Barbados. And in that idea of Barbados, he spoke of how the other islands in the region looked up to Barbados, and the idea of what a small island developing country could do with so limited resources. This is all leadership, and it is under threat. Believe me. But we cannot take the past with us. We now have to lay the path to rest. If we're going to open our arms to this new and glorious future, we cannot be extending our arms backward. The future is too big and too glorious. But adaptive work, which is what we have here in terms of leadership, requires that we release some of the DNA. There's something that we can keep from the past, of course, but there's some things that we know must let go. And there's some new things that we have to learn as we go forward. And I want to tell you all a story about a man who owned a canoe. There was a man who lived on an island in utter and total deprivation. From this island, he could see in the distance another island. And on that island, people were doing very, very well. So he said to himself, if I could only make it to that island, then I too would do very well. But he did not have a single way to get to the other side. And so he committed himself to finding a raft, a boat, a canoe, anything to take him to the other side because the distance was too much to swim. Eventually he found himself a canoe. That is the exact canoe. I took a picture of it from 100 years ago. Anyway, he made up in his mind that if he could find a canoe, he would make it to the other side. And so he did. Eventually, he found himself a canoe, carried it above his head to the edge of the water, and sailed to the other side. When he got to the other side, he found it as glorious as he had imagined. Everybody was healthier. The women were pretty. The buildings were nice. The streets were clean. It was a great place to live. But he was so thankful to his canoe that he took the canoe up, carried it above his head, and carried it everywhere he went. He could not understand why it was that in the midst of all this greatness and this affluence, that he alone was suffering. He did not understand that there comes a point where an asset becomes a liability. And there has to be a point where we put down our canoe. That time is now, and we need to look to the future. So, what do we need to do now as we go forward? We must practice adaptive leadership. And I will run through these relatively quickly. One of the things that we need to do is to properly diagnose the situation. What is it that we are truly faced with? These are uncertain times. What are we really facing? We need to spend time doing the diagnostic check. Because most people fail not because they're doing the wrong things, you know, but because they got the problem wrong in the first place. We have to spend more time identifying the real issue, identifying the people that will help us to resolve it. That said, then, we must explore very tough interpretations. Now, there's some things that are happening in Barbados that are due to the economic recession. Of course. But there are many things that are happening in Barbados that has nothing to do with the economic recession. Just poor choices. So we must be able to say to ourselves, when we explore these interpretations, some of this is my fault. We have to understand the process challenges and the people challenges. The problem behind the problem is oftentimes something to do with people. We have to understand those relationships and try to fix them where we can. Because as we go forward, we can't take forward some and not the rest. We must take forward everyone. We have to explore multiple ideas. And this is perhaps the most challenging, I think, for a political pro. Because people who are in politics and have been in politics for a long time, or have been in leadership for a long time, or have been an authority figure for a long time, believe that they alone communicate with God, and God gives them the ideas to carry forward like he did with Moses and Mount Sinai. It is difficult to accept that there are multiple people now, because people have access to information in ways now that they never had before. We have to take on board the multiple ideas that people have and be curious about them, and be curious about it. There is no way in a room that one person has all the solutions. Impossible. And that idea of, I am a leader, and you are a follower, and I have all the ideas, and you have none of the ideas, is bankrupt. Imagine if the leader then dies. Point two assumes the position of point one. And automatically, he has all the ideas, he has all the solutions, and everybody else becomes a follower. The system makes no sense. But we have honored that system for a long, long time. And it is time to change that system. We have a responsibility now to energize people. And I look forward over the next few months and few years to being part of a team that understands what it means to energize people. Part of our duty is to engage unusual voices. Politicians know this well. Knock on every door. Go to people who traditionally you have not had the opportunity to speak to. Not only your supporters or your constituents or the people who are born poor like me. Embrace difference. Go to every single household. Engage unusual voices in the process of adaptive work. And we must start where people are. There is a way that people in authority move in. They have access to information oftentimes that the rest do not have. They hoard this information. And then in a conversation with you, they treat you as if you are less smart than they are because they have not held on to information that you don't have. It has nothing to do with smart. It is a manipulative approach to managing people and a manipulative approach to leading. We have to engage people and to start where people are. People in 2016 are a lot further than they were many years ago by virtue of just having access to a great deal of information and being able to assimilate in their own minds and make their own interpretations. People are not foolish, and we must stop treating people as if they are. You can go on any block in Barbados, almost at any time, and have a conversation about the most profound issues in the most profound way and get insight in ways that you could never get in the boardroom. We must also speak to loss. And it's a very difficult thing to do. A few years ago when I was director of a department, constituency informer department, we ran a program, a parenting program. And that parenting program was responsible for teaching young mothers how to be better parents. And in the beginning, the room was full. All these young women came and wanted to hear about how to be a better parent. But eventually, over time, the crowd dwindled and dwindled with excuses and excuses. I then had a conversation, fortunately, with one of the ladies. She gave me all the initial excuses, but then she told me the truth. It is very difficult to go to a parenting program to hear time and time again about how bad a parent I am. And while we think we are teaching one thing, and while we think we're engaging people on one level, they're hearing it over their own experiences. And the sense of loss that they must come to terms with when we say to you there is a better way to parent, what they're hearing is, you are a bad parent. And it happens across various spheres of activity. We think we're saying one thing and people are hearing another thing. We have to respect the loss we are asking people to bear when we try to make a change. Because adaptation hurts, and adaptation is painful. But above all, I think these last two are very important. We have to reinforce our collective purpose. What is it that we stand for? What does the Barbados Labour Party stand for? And to share that with every single person with whom we come into contact. And then to restore hope to people. What do we stand for? How do we return hope? It is a conversation that is one and the same. Because what we stand for will, by virtue of what it is, restore hope to people in this country that have lost hope. And I want now to explain. Oh, I haven't changed my. Not the letter prayer. I want to talk now about some elements in our social sector. I want to talk about education for a bit. I want to talk about the social services sector proper for a bit. And I want to talk about youth issues for a bit. We have now almost daily some issue in education. We had an issue with a child who refused to pick up a wrapper that consumed the thought of a whole education ministry, a whole media, the thoughts of a whole country, and at the end of it, we still don't have a clue if this thing has been properly resolved. We have a situation with head teachers and teachers who are coming into confrontation all the time, and our solution is to transfer either the teacher or the head. We still don't know if the situation is resolved. At Combermere now, there is a stinking tree. But that tree stood for so long that I can hardly believe that we're talking about a tree. But here are our solutions. Suspend the child. Transfer the teacher. Maybe cut down the tree. Technical solutions where we clearly have adaptive issues. We do not know what the situation will be, but we do know that it requires some conversation and engagement. But above and beyond those issues, which I think are small manifestations of real problems in education, there are other things that we must address. Attitudinally, we must make a change. We now must prepare our students to be able to cope in the new world. People must be able to engage in free and critical thinking. How do we teach our children to express themselves freely
and not come into confrontation daily with authority figures who do not understand that these are different times. And every person who expresses themselves is not trying to be rude to you. And you must not rely on your authority every single time someone says to you something that you find offensive. Because these are different times. And children will express themselves differently. And as mature people, with a 4% difference between us and the chimpanzee, our capacity to reason and to empathize must come into play when we are dealing with our children. And when they're dealing with mine. Because it is a serious, serious thing. We have children now who do not understand things the way we want it. Children do not see marijuana use the way we did. And I'm not saying this is right or wrong. Children do not see gender issues the same way we once did, because the world has changed. Children do not see race issues in many cases the way we once did. Their realities are so different. And we are trying to impose a 1950s mindset on a 2016 generation. But there are different issues as well that are at play. We must reform our curriculum. There will be many people who are poor, we call them the transient poor. They will pass through poverty. You cannot deny a person who is passing through poverty access to the resources of the state. They should have access to the resources of the state because it says we understand, we empathize, and we know that because of these circumstances, you now find yourself in these conditions. It is not your nature to be poor. But the circumstances in which you find yourself have caused you now to be poor, and a caring government and a caring state will assist you, or should assist you. Difficult to do when you're cutting assistance to these agencies. So now we have a real challenge in the social services sector. And again, we have to address it. But it does not end there. I want to talk lastly about the youth, because this is a big concern for me. A few years ago, I addressed an audience, many used to do the St. Michael Cathedral midday lectures. And I spoke then, while I was legitimately young, I spoke then on the topic of the marginalization of young people in Barbadian society. And the canon who was at the church at the time made a point that has left me up to this day quite bewildered. And I said that there is a need for leadership from the church. And he said to me, the young people are out there and they're suffering. The church is here. If these people want guidance, they must come to the church. The church has no responsibility going out there. The canon of the church blew my mind. It is a mindset that many people have. Not only the canon, it is a leadership problem. It needs to be fixed. How dare him, or anyone in that position, decide for themselves that they will not engage people? I mean, these are not people that we appointed. These are people who are apparently appointed by God and are told to go and make disciples of men, but will choose to stay in their little corner of the world and not engage people. Can you imagine? We also now have a government that chooses not to engage people. Silence is not golden. It cannot be when people are suffering. But we now have to find a way to engage people and bring them into the development process, because if we don't, we are going to lose a large section of our society, the young people, who are an asset to this country, who have a contribution to make, but who feel as if that contribution is not being taken seriously in this country. And now, on top of all these things, we are asking them now to leave university with a great amount of debt, to try to start a business with that debt when it's already hard to get a loan, to recognize that over 70% of businesses will fail anyway, and that they, young people, represent a disproportionate share of those people who will fail if they attempt to start a business. And we have to get that right. We also have a set of young people who speak a completely different language, dress a different way. It is a culture that we misunderstand. We call it deviant. We call it rude. But not everyone who you see speaking like a rude boy or the dress like a rude boy is a rude boy. It is a style. We must stop judging people. I have been judged many times. My friends have been judged. When I was looking for a job in the 90s, I was using my great aunt's address because she lived in Regency Park and I lived in the Pine. And I knew that it was more likely for somebody to assume that if I lived in Regency Park, that I was a good boy. And that if I came from the Pine, that I must have been a bad boy. We have been judged for a long time. We need to stop judging people and give young people a fair chance. But there is, as they approach the end, and I want to talk about what I think is this new understanding of the economy. I have spoken about the social services sector. A lot of what I said is relevant to many other sectors. The problem is the same. We need to strengthen a lot of our social institutions. But there is a rhetoric that I hear time and time again about Barbados is more than an economy. It is a society. Rubbish. That is an artificial divide. To separate the economy from the society is a problem and a flaw. It sounds good, but it makes no sense. And it is dangerous policy. Trust me, it is not only my thinking on this matter. And I want to give you a definition by Midgley, who is a social development specialist. And he says, social development is the process of planned social change designed to promote the well-being of a population as a whole in conjunction with a dynamic process of economic development. Social development and economic development. All in one. Barbados is more than an economy. Barbados is a society. It's basic. But if you are using it to separate the things because you feel you have a claim to the social development of this country, then it is simply wrong and manipulative. Manipulative for a number of reasons. One, because it is not true. But two, because the record of the Barbados Labour Party when it comes to social development outshines any other institution by far. By far. And we have nothing of which to be ashamed. And we need to tell our story and stop having people frame this narrative and decide for us who it is that we are. Remember Bob? Bob is my friend. And a few years ago, when we were told that subsidies and preferential treatment for bananas and sugarcane was coming to an end, our authority figures engaged. I mean, they did try to make a change. And I want to give them the due. But that they failed to engage the planters, the farmers, and so on. So many farmers found when the subsidies were taken away, and when they then had to compete on an open market, that they could not compete because they were not prepared for it. And they found themselves responding to a threat that they should have seen coming. Today, it is still very much the same. There are many things now happening on the international market, and we are not having those conversations. There is an issue in our banking sector. It's called de-risking. You should Google it, because it is a serious thing. A lot of international banks are now pulling out of alliances with a lot of local banks. They do so because they fear they have a risk associated with a lot of these banks. And what happens is, to protect their own interests and their own assets, they take themselves away from a relationship with Caribbean banks. It's happening in Belize, it could potentially happen here. The government is trying to deal with it, they really are. They're putting in a lot of effort. But it's the same problem with the bananas. They're not engaging the people. So if it doesn't go well, we could find ourselves again responding to a threat that we should have seen coming and for which we are completely unprepared. We need to engage on that level. Because what could happen is that many people could wake up one morning and find themselves bankless. It is a serious thing. And there needs to be a conversation with the average Barbadian, the average Caribbean citizen about the nature of this threat. climate change. My friend Natalie is here, and she's our climate change specialist. And she has told me time and time again, Barbados needs to go green. And we should not be doing things that are outside of going green. But yet we want to start Cahill. And Cahill has a responsibility for garbage. And in order to meet the amount of garbage that they need to be functional, they have to import garbage. And while we should be going green, we are looking at policies that will import garbage. It is the anti-green policy. Cahill is still an issue. And we must not stop until Cahill is stopped. Because Cahill is a threat to our development. Renewable energy as well. You know, when oil was expensive and we were struggling, there was a lot of talk about renewable energy and we're going to get the sun and the moon and the stars and water and we're going to do all these things. But now oil has dropped and the conversation is deep. Eventually, the price of oil will go back up. It is obvious. And now that we have economic space, we need to be talking about these things as they relate to the development of this country and talking seriously about renewable energy. And engaging Barbadians about what it is that we now must do to move this country forward. But we are not doing it because we are authority figures. We do not understand that the process of engagement is a permanent thing. But it is time for change. I assure you that change is coming soon enough. Full strain, I often hear of it more. Full strain. What is missing? And I've said to you that the issues really are about diagnostic options. It is not about having solutions, but it is about engaging in conversations about what is missing. Who is missing from the conversation? What do we now need to do to fix Barbados and to get Barbados back on the development path? What are these challenges? Leadership must involve compassion, curiosity, reasoning, and care. That is the new kind of leadership that Barbados must have. And I have often said that those of us who assume leadership must be able to receive anger with grace. And most people who speak to you angrily as a leadership person or authority figure do so not because they dislike you or they dislike me, but it is because they are experiencing their own hurt and that they are struggling. And if we understood the sound beneath the words, then we would not respond to them in the way that we have over time. Either we will do this regardless of what you think, or somebody is my friend. We have to understand the sound beneath the words. And in some cases, it is a rebel song. So what? People are upset. But in some cases, it is a redemption song. And that is okay. But whatever or however people present themselves to us, we have a responsibility to receive them with grace and with care, because it is they who will put us in the position that we are in, and that we only stand tall because we stand on the shoulders of people. And I know it is very difficult to do, to be on the dance floor and off of it at the same time, to be in action and reflecting at the same time, to be in the middle of a fight and step back and say, hey, am I deploying myself effectively? Is this the best way for me? Should I be doing something differently? But in the midst of a crisis, we have to be experimenting. And leadership is an improvisational art. We will not always get it right. But sometimes you have to give yourself the latitude to say, I have made a bad decision, step back, reflect, make corrective action, and then re-engage. It is arrogance. It is arrogance that makes us do otherwise. That makes us afraid to apologize and afraid to say we must now take a different course. And Lee Kuan Yew, who is one of the greatest leaders apparently of all times in Singapore, he understood this. When he assumed leadership of Singapore, he had in his mind a policy that was very nationalistic. But when he came face to face with the realities of his country and his time, he decided he had to open up his market and to start a new conversation and to move people forward differently. And in so doing, he disappointed a whole lot of people. But look at where Singapore is today. shining example of what a developing country can do with effective leadership. We have to understand this. We really, really must. And one of the things that we have to do ultimately is restore faith in the government. People have lost faith. People have lost hope in the political process. And everybody who sees you thinks, well, if you were associated with politics, then you're politics, and you are a fraud and a trickster, and that all you want is what is in it for yourself. And the truth is, I genuinely do not believe that. Because I have seen people who put themselves into political life bend and distort themselves in ways to accommodate people because they have put people first. But people don't get that. Because some people, having come to political life for all the wrong reasons. And instead of being able to help people, they have hurt people. And when we assume office soon enough, and even now in opposition, we have to restore hope to a broken people. We have to secure the future. And our future, I believe, is rich. That's my daughter. She's very important to me, of course. And I have a friend who's here, and my friend Denise Stannis, who has an NGO called Action for Justice, and on May 14th, there will be a march for child protection, and I will be in it. She's asking to be a champion. I'm asking you all to join us, because we have to take care of children in particular. And where are we now? I have said to you that I believe in regionalism. I make no apologies for it. I think the way forward for Barbados and the Caribbean is as one. We have to be one. I think the way forward for Barbados is to get past our petty divides and to recognize that as Barbadians, we are also one. That anybody who is attempting to lead in Barbados must be one. And that is necessary as we move forward. And Barbados now requires a new government and a new citizen. And we have to become that. We have to become one of the things that is necessary to lead Barbados forward. If Barbados is going to be what it has traditionally been, then again, we also have to be one. And lastly, Barbados has been great, and Barbados will continue to be great. And Barbadians, as I said, have borne the brunt of our development struggles for generations. And they will do so once they believe they have been engaged honestly and that they can trust their leadership. We have to offer a kind of leadership that people can believe in and that people can have faith in. The time demands that we get it right. We do not have time now to play. The time for play is over. There is too much at stake now. It is time for action. So all of us, in our different ways, acting in our different spaces, we need to put the interests of this country first and foremost. Barbados is a gem of a place. Regardless of the hands that now ill-treat it, Barbados is still a gem of a place. And we must restore Barbados to its proper position. So leadership is now what is needed for Barbados. Adaptive leadership. And I genuinely believe that leadership is what we will bring when we assume the reins of government soon enough, and we are able to take care of the needs of poor people, and take care of the elderly, and the vulnerable, and those who are suffering, and those who are hurting, and restore our middle class, and do all the things that have now gone, all the things that should be up are down, and all the things that should be down are up. Barbados is in reverse. We need to restore Barbados to its rightful place. I believe in the nurse.